to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Before the world was made, you were the King of Kings. Yes, you were. Yes, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out. We join them as we sing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Matchless name, all my days, all my days. So let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Thank you. Well, good morning and happy Easter. Now, you might be expecting a joke from me, but actually I'm not going to do a joke today, because as Reverend Gannon, my brother Jeff, has often taught us, that Easter Monday is a day to tell jokes all day. So I encourage you to spend Monday telling some jokes to each other. You can recycle some of my bad ones. It's up to you. But again, happy Easter. So glad you are with us. Would you join me now in the Litany of Easter? Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I invite you now to join in singing together an Easter hymn called Easter Celebration. It's appropriate to our day and yet sung to a familiar tune.
Beautiful hymn for this day. Let's pray together. O Lord, we gather to worship and celebrate you on this Resurrection Sunday. The resurrection gives us every reason to have hope in the midst of a national emergency, but also in the challenges in our everyday lives. In the resurrection, we discover that we have every reason to believe that you keep your promises. You are the way for those who are lost and needing direction and have been told there is no way. You are the truth for us all, the truth about your unending love, the truth about your extraordinary grace and the forgiveness of sins, the truth that you are the blessed hope for those especially living on the edge of losing everything. You've been telling us that you are also the life, and that because you rose from the grave, we too have hope for a new life by that same power to become new creations. And you promised that we might have goodness and mercy all the days of our lives. So yes, you are the way and the truth and the life. And because you came back, we can come back. We can come back from sickness to health, from poverty to riches, from darkness to light. And we can come back even from death to new life through Jesus Christ. It is in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you, Aura, for that beautiful Easter piece. Crown Him with Many Crowns is one of our favorite Easter hymns. Good morning and welcome. We're so glad that you have joined us for online Easter worship. Even though we aren't together here in this sanctuary, we are one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. So welcome. We pray that this service will be a blessing to you. I also want to remind you that we are continuing our prayer ministry. You will notice at the bottom of your screen the email address to which you send your prayer requests. Please let us know how we can pray for you. Pastor Jan is in charge of our congregational care team, and we continue this ministry of prayer each and every day. It would be of help if you would send that prayer request before noon tomorrow so that all of the 100-plus persons who pray can receive their lists tomorrow afternoon. Also, I want to encourage you to continue to participate in the many Zoom classes that are available for children, youth, and adults. The e-newsletter has all of the information as well as the church's website, so I encourage you to go check it out. I want you to know that we are here for you as your pastoral staff, and if you have a need, I encourage you to call the number that is at the bottom of the screen. Even though the church office is closed, we are here to serve you. 316-261-8006. During this difficult time, we give thanks for your prayers. On behalf of the staff, I want you to know that we feel your prayers. We experience God's peace and presence because you're praying for us as we pray for you. Thank you. Also, we give thanks for your financial gifts. During this time, we're incredibly grateful that you continue to remember the church with your financial gifts. In case you don't know, you can give online through the website. Please go to the main page at www.chapelhillwichita.org, and it will direct you to the upper right-hand corner where there is an online giving box. You can check it, and it will help you the rest of the way. Some of you prefer to give by mail, and we have a locked box here at the church for security so that we can receive that check by mail and you don't have to worry about it getting lost. Also, please send your check to the church in care of Julie Hay, H-E-Y, in order to guard your confidentiality. I had somebody ask me recently, can I give through texting? As a matter of fact, you can. The number will appear at the bottom of your screen, and you simply text GIVE, and it will direct you on what to do next. Also, I want to remind you that Dylan's has a program where you're invited to sign up to support a charity. And out of a pool of money, all of the charities that are signed up receive a portion of the amount that you spend every single year. So I encourage you to support Chapel Hill as a charity of choice if you are not supporting another charity at this time. Thank you for your support in so many ways that remind us that we are the body of Christ together. Now, as we prepare for the pastoral prayer given by Pastor Jen, please hear the sacred word from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. For the Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Will you pray with me? Living Christ, it is early in our darkness as we make our way to the tomb. There is so much death and pain and sorrow all around us that it is hard to hope, hard to believe, hard to be the Easter people this year. Even though we know how the story ends, even more how it begins out of the ashes of Good Friday and moves into the empty tomb, this day, God, we are simply struggling to hold on. O gracious God, in your gentle, patient mercy, hear us, meet us, hold us. God of life, God of all, we pause in our own pain and weariness to lift those around us, for those who are working endless hours without much sleep to provide essential medical care, essential food, essential services, those who are on the front line standing for all of us, loving others with their very lives. We pray for strength. We pray for protection. We pray for Zoe life to fill each heart. God of hope and your boundless grace, hear us. God of miracles, we pause on this day of all days, the day when we are vividly reminded that nothing can stop you. And we plead for your help in this battle with the coronavirus. Guide those working to find a treatment, a vaccine, even a cure. Give your wisdom and bring us all healing. In your unshakable love, hear us. On this day of all days, when we celebrate that even death could not stop you, we lift to you all those on our prayer list, naming especially Kim Donald's son Bronson, Paul Longhofer, Jeff Hoag, Colton Hurt, Corey Davis, Lori Shunk, Rick Robbins, Judy Miller, Gareth Smith, and those that we now name in our hearts. Even as we celebrate life, we know there are many who are grieving death. We continue to pray for Ann Womack, Kim Clark, Claudia Kucharik, Carol and Carl Childs, Candy Manners, and all those who are saying goodbye to loved ones even now. Bring comfort, bring peace, and help us to be your love in the midst. Merciful God, in your unstoppable life, hear us. Living Christ, on this day of all days, most of all, we thank you. We thank you that we are never alone, that there is never anything too dark, too scary, too overwhelming to stop you. You are the Lord of life, and you are our Lord. We praise you, we need you, we love you. You are risen indeed, and because you live, we shall live also. In your most powerful name we pray. Amen.
Happy Easter, girls and boys. I'm sorry that we can't be together today, but we can at least have a children's sermon together. I wore my Easter tie for you today. It's got the bright orange and then the pastel colors of purple and blue and green, just like my Easter eggs. I'm wondering, have you dyed your Easter eggs yet? Now, I want to share with you that the reason we dye Easter eggs is that we're communicating, we're talking about Easter. And this is a teaching tool. This tells us something about Easter. So, in the early church, when people were observing Lent, the 40 days minus Sundays before they would celebrate Easter, they would give up all dairy, all meat, all eggs. And the first thing they would do on Easter Sunday is that they would wake up and they would all eat eggs as a way of saying, it's Easter. But then, as time went on, they said, well, this egg can actually teach us the story of Easter. So they used their imaginations and they pretended that the egg was the tomb. And then when it came time to eat the egg, they would break open the egg and they would say, the tomb is open and it's empty. Jesus is alive. But then, as time went on, they said, this could also be a teaching tool about what it means to follow Jesus. So the church way back then would take flowers from the field and they would paint the eggs as a way of saying, this is a joyful time. And they would use really bright colors. And they wanted to make sure that everybody knows that Easter is a time for joy. Then, as time went on, they said, well, it also teaches us something about baptism, that when we experience the water of baptism, we go in like this, a white egg, and we come out different. We're more colorful, we're more alive. That when we are baptized, Jesus says, "You're mine, I love you, I'm with you forever." So I hope that you will take some time to dye eggs and to remember the Easter story. Jesus is alive, and all these colorful eggs remind us. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
The Gospel for the Feast of the Resurrection is according to the evangelist Matthew. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him.' This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." While they were going, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests everything that had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that we can be born again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angels upon the tombstone said, "He is risen, just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia." Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that we can be born again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angels upon the tombstone said, "He is risen, just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia."
What a blessing it is to have Ernest Alexander, the great singer from Wichita, and his accompanist, Craig. We're always blessed when they offer the ministry of music. So thank you, Ernest and Craig, for blessing us today. Would you pray with me, please? Lord, may the words of my mouth and may the thoughts of every heart in every place be acceptable in your sight, because you and you alone are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Some of you know I come from a railroad family, and I picked a slide that shows the Empire Builder Amtrak train, passenger train, that goes across the great state of Montana. This is in one of the more beautiful parts. My mother and I used to ride the Amtrak passenger trains across the state of Montana to go visit my sister, who lived at the time in Spokane, Washington. So I'll never forget, we were coming back from Spokane after Christmas. It was January the 2nd, 1977. We were traveling across Montana, 2 hours from our destination of Glendive, Montana. It was dark. It was about 8 p.m. It was extremely cold, 20 below zero natural temperature, with about 15 or 20 additional degrees below zero wind chill factor. It was extremely cold. And as we were riding in the car that provided snacks and games and all of that, all of a sudden, in the midst of going 80 miles an hour, which is typical for Amtrak, there was a noise that I have never heard before or since. And it was incredibly loud, and within a matter of seconds, this is what happened to our train. We had derailed. The car that my mother and I were in looked like the one that you're seeing on the screen. It was about to tip over. The conductor ran through our car, yelling as loudly as he could, "Don't move! Don't move! Don't move!" And there was a stunned silence. And then this woman, whom I didn't know, said, and I quote, "Dang!" Only she didn't say "dang" because that's not a word in Montana. She said, "Dang! What just happened?" We could say the same thing about COVID-19, couldn't we? Everything's going along pretty well, and all of a sudden, things are very different. We could have collectively said, "Dang, what happened?" On Good Friday, the followers of Jesus must have had a similar emotional reaction. On Palm Sunday, everything was great. "Hosanna! Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is Jesus who comes in the name of the Lord." Everybody laying out their palm branches, adoring this Jesus marching into Jerusalem. And 5 days later, he's dead. It's as if the people of God were saying, "Dang, what happened?" 2 days later, Matthew, the gospel writer, the evangelist, tells us that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, they go to the tomb out of respect, out of honor for the one to whom they have given everything. Naturally, they're full of grief and pain. They go to the grave, if you will, the same reason we go to the graves of loved ones we have, because we feel a connection. We feel a bond. In spite of the pain of the loss, it makes us feel better. Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany do the very same thing. They go to the tomb of Jesus to experience connection with the one that they deeply love. And so in Matthew's gospel, it says that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb, and suddenly there was an earthquake. No, not just an earthquake. There was a great earthquake. I would imagine that a great earthquake is the kind that gets your attention. This last summer, I was working out at the North Y on a Saturday morning at about 7:30 a.m., and all of a sudden, the machine I was on began to shake, and the lights went off, and the air conditioner stopped, and the fire alarm went off, and all of a sudden, there was a voice that said, "Everybody exit the building," and we all ran out. I'll never forget that Saturday morning. It got my attention. Matthew is the only gospel writer who says that on the day of resurrection, there was an earthquake. And why is he saying and emphasizing that there was a great earthquake? Because God takes what is and dramatically enters into what is, and is at work to make all things new. Matthew wants us to know that the earthquake is a part of the story because it is a symbol of God breaking in and God breaking through and God doing something that only God can do. Matthew is the gospel writer who wants to remind us that Jesus is Emmanuel, that God is with us, that we live in a God-bathed world, not in a God-abandoned world. Did you hear that? Matthew does not want anyone to forget that we live in a God-bathed world in spite of death and destruction and disease. The whole of the Christian gospel, the good news that we have to proclaim, is that God, in and through the person of Jesus Christ, enters the muck and mire of the human experience in order to heal us, in order to restore us, in order to build us up and to make us more than we already are. That's an important theme in the Gospel of Matthew. And Matthew repeatedly shows us how Jesus is entering in. And the earthquake is a way of saying, pay attention. Look up. Notice. When we were in Jerusalem, we went to the garden tomb, as you can see it here. And it's beautiful, but it's sterile, and it's nice. And on this day, it was anything but that. Because God enters in to things as they are, even when they're not pretty, when they're not dressed up, even when there's nothing but despair. So Matthew says that the women are feeling the power of God. I call them the first Quakers, out of deference to Pastor Ben. They're quaking in their soul, realizing something's up. But then if you look on the screen, you will see that according to the text, they not only feel the power of God, they see the power of God in and through an angel, a heavenly messenger who rolls back the tomb. And what does the heavenly messenger do? Matthew is the only gospel that says it. The angel sits on the stone. Now, what in the world is that about? Have you noticed that before? Why in the world is the angel sitting on the stone? This kind of looks like Will Ferrell sitting on the stone. Is the angel sitting there because he's worn out from moving the stone? Is he sitting there because it was too big of a job for too small of an angel? Is it because his flapping got a little old and a little tired, needed a break? What's going on here? What does Matthew want us to know about it? On the biggest day of the year, the chief angel is sitting down on the job. Go figure. And yet, on a more serious level, this angel, he may be sitting down on the job, but he hasn't lost his persuasiveness. He has not lost his ability to do his job because, what does he say? What does he do? Well, the guards, for fear of the angel, started shaking. They too are Quakers, and they become like dead men. Now, what's going on here? I want you to know, as I dissect this passage of Scripture, Matthew does not have any fat on the meat. This is all meat, and there's no baloney. I mean, this is good stuff, but man, it's loaded. What is Matthew trying to say about the effect of the angel? Tom Long, who's a Presbyterian minister as well as a professor of preaching, says, these soldiers must surely be the unluckiest assignment in military history. Their job was to make sure that Jesus stayed in the grave. Is it any wonder the soldiers are acting like zombies? They had one job, seemingly simple, and they blow it. There again, the angel may be sitting down, but he's still doing his job because he spoke to the women from his perch. So you see, the women are feeling the power of God, they're seeing the power of God, and now they hear the power of God. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. And there you will see him. And this is my message for you." Now let me ask you, what do the women do in response to the word from the seated angel? Do they have a theological conference to see whether or not the angel is legit? Do they confer with the angel in order to test him and to find out if he's really accurate? Do they come up with a list of reasons as to why it would not be a good idea to take the news to the men? What do the women do? Verse 8, they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Do you remember that commercial years ago? This ages me, I realize, makes my hair grayer than it already is. That commercial where the professional cleaner person said, "I'm a professional cleaner, but I don't do windows." You remember that? I'm so thankful that Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany didn't say, "Well, we don't do tombs. We don't do errands for angels. We don't do messenger roles. We don't run to men who aren't likely to listen to us." Whenever I'm asked why I support pastors who are women when Jesus only had male disciples, I don't have to say much. I just point them to this story. Who were the proclaimers of the good news? Verse 8, they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. Did you catch it? Fear and great joy. That's why I've titled this sermon, Mixed Emotions. Have you ever had mixed emotions? Have you, like Mary Magdalene and Mary of Bethany, experienced both fear and great joy at the same time? I have. In fact, rather recently, with all of this coronavirus, I've shared with you before, if you're going to be aware, you cannot help but feel fear. Yet, during this coronavirus, my family and I, we have spent more time playing board games on Friday or Saturday nights, which we typically only do during the holidays, but it has been a great source of joy. Fear and great joy all at the same time? Yes. I don't know if you've been following the Cuomos. On your left is the Cuomo, Chris, who is an anchor for CNN. And on his right is his brother, older brother, governor of New York, Andrew. Chris was diagnosed as being positive, having the coronavirus. And so this show illustrates what happened when Andrew called Chris. And in the midst of that conversation, Andrew is saying, "My brother Chris, I love him. I have to tell you, I'm scared for him. I'm scared for myself. He's my brother. He's my best friend. It brings me great joy to know that we're family. But I'm scared." Mixed emotions, fear and great joy. Yet Matthew wants us to know that the women left the room of the tomb with mixed emotions. Why is that so important? Well, as Jim said last week in his sermon, there's no shame or blame when it comes to the emotion of fear. It's a real emotion, and we should not judge it. God created us with the capacity to feel fear. It's part of the human experience. But it is also an emotion that has the power to run us, to ruin us, to run amok, if you will. In the resurrection account, according to Matthew, 10 times in this very short story, "Be not afraid, be not afraid, be not afraid." In the whole of the Bible, 366 times is the message, "Be not afraid." That's one for every day of the year plus leap year. Raymond Brown, the great biblical scholar, says something very important. Hear this. This is important. The message of "be not afraid" is not God's way of saying you're a terrible bad person if you have any amount of fear, or you're not a person of faith if you have any fear, or you lack trust if you have fear. That's not the message of God, Dr. Brown says. He goes on to say the message of "be not afraid" is simply don't get stuck there, move with it and through it. So hear this, please. The women do exactly that. They move. They don't become disempowered or immobilized by their fear. They move physically and spiritually and emotionally forward with their fear. And how do they do it? Well, look at the screen. This is really important. What keeps fear in check is joy. What keeps fear from taking over the soul is joy. Genuine joy is always more powerful than fear. Now, some of you know I respect the work of Brené Brown. Her YouTube video on vulnerability and shame is the highest viewed YouTube video in history. 12 million views. It grows exponentially every single day. What does that tell us? She says, and I quote, "The relationship between joy and gratitude was one of the most important pieces of research that I discovered." She said, "I wasn't expecting it, but in my 12 years of research on 11,000 pieces of data, I did not interview one person who had described themselves as joyful who also did not actively practice gratitude. For me, it was very counterintuitive because I went into the research thinking that the relationship between joy and gratitude was, if you're joyful, you'll be grateful. But in reality, the research showed it's exactly the opposite. Practicing gratitude leads to joy. Now, Jim talked about this last week, and I'm talking about it again because it is vital to our well-being, especially when it comes to the days of our lives. She went on to say, I discovered this is not an attitude of gratitude. It is not the momentary feeling grateful, as important as those things are. She said, I'm talking about people who practice gratitude. They practice gratitude. They practice gratitude. I'm purposefully redundant. When I was studying psychology, I learned that you can determine the level of fear within a person by listening to the amount of complaining that they share. My professor of psychology that I dearly adore to this day said, complaining is a sign of fear. She would say to us as her students, when we would be complaining, well, I have some cheese to go with your wine. Now tell me, what are you really afraid of? Have you noticed how often people are complaining today? And especially people who don't normally complain? The more you hear people complain, the more fearful they are. And if you and I, like the women at the tomb, want to move forward in spite of our fear, we must practice gratitude. Every single day, I encourage you, I challenge you to develop a practice of gratitude. Specific things you do: writing in a journal of gratitude, putting sticky notes up on your mirror. There's a variety of things. You can look it up. Well, the story goes on. Suddenly, as the women are going, Jesus met them and said, greetings! And they came to him and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Now, when Jesus greeted them, it wasn't, hi. When Jesus greeted them, the Greek word there means rejoice exceedingly. When Jesus pursued the women, when Jesus met the women, Jesus was exceedingly glad to see them. Do you hear the difference? Here's what I want you to hear. Jesus met them. Jesus pursued them. Jesus did not wait for them. Jesus went to them. Remember the overarching theme of Matthew? God is faithful to break in and to break through what is in order to make all things new. And here's what I want you to hear. Wherever you are emotionally, spiritually, relationally, today, Jesus is passionately pursuing you and will meet you at the point of your deepest need and your most tender pain. That's why the psalmist says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me? No, shall pursue me. Goodness and mercy shall pursue me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, which is meaning God will never give up. God will pursue with passion. God did it for Mary Magdalene. God did it for Mary of Bethany. God has done it for me. God will do it for you. Now, there's a lot more to this story, but for the sake of time, let me close. John Ortberg and Dallas Willard are two people that you hear quoted a lot from this pulpit. And John Ortberg was going through a very difficult time. Life was really hard for him. In fact, he says, and I quote, "During this painful time of my life, if my life were to end, I would not have cared." So he calls Dallas Willard, tells him the whole situation. And he said, "I waited for Dallas to say, 'I feel your pain. I know this is hard.'" He said, "Dallas didn't say that." There was a long pause after listening intently on the part of Dallas. And then Dallas said, "John, this will be a test of your joyful confidence in God. John, this will be a test of your joyful confidence in God." My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, that's where we are today. Life is hard. Times are tough. But this is our opportunity to believe that God, who passionately pursues us in Jesus, is asking us to have joyful confidence in the God who will break in and break through. That's the good news of Easter. Amen. I invite you now to stand with me and join in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Well, I hope you've gotten your communion elements ready and that you're ready to join me now as we celebrate communion together. And I invite you to join me in the prayer we do every week called the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn of praise as together we say, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Jesus who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us celebrate the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. All glory, honor, and praise be yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please join me now in praying the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to take your elements, the body of Christ, broken for you, the blood of Christ, shed for you. It's good that we can celebrate this sacred meal in any way we can, and this is what we have now. So may you be blessed, you and your family and friends, as you take this sacred meal together. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia, for singing that great old favorite, My Redeemer Liveth. So I invite you now to stand in your homes, if you're able, to not only receive the benediction, but also out of respect for the Hallelujah Chorus. We tried to get a recording of our choir. Unfortunately, it didn't work. So we're going to play the Hallelujah Chorus as sung by the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. They do a beautiful job. So receive this benediction, please. Because the tomb is empty, our lives can be full. Go forth in peace, and may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon us and remind us that we are the beloved children of the living God. Amen and amen.
Oh, Lord God, give us
your back and the sun on your face, with a song in your heart and the promise of grace. Go in peace and in truth, and let love lead your way. Go with God. Go with God. Go with the wind at your back and the sun on your face, with a song in your heart and the promise of grace. Go in peace and in truth, and let love lead your way. Go with God.